I'm very nervous because I don't do well speaking in front of people, but I'm very excited to be able to share with you everything God's done in my life. I was always an overweight person, and was married, and I wasn't happily married, and I just kept gaining weight and gaining weight. And so I went and had my stomach stapled and weighed 356 pounds at the time I had that done. And then I came back and I still wasn't happy. I still didn't feel loved because I grew up believing my dad didn't love me. And angry at my mom because she didn't make him stop picking on me. So I just kept gaining weight, you know, and after I couldn't gain weight anymore, I started drinking. And the drinking became a really problem for me. And everybody would tell me, you need to go get help for your drinking. And I would get so angry because they were all drinkers that were telling me this. And it was like, you know, you better get the log out of your own eye first. You know? I grew up in a Lutheran church, so, but I didn't know God. I didn't know anything. I just went because that's what my family did, you know. There was no life in the church or anything. So at treatment, I finally, my friend says, Joanne, you need to go find you. And that was the words that God must have put the right words in her mouth because that's what I needed to hear. So off to treatment I go, and of course, first night they make you go to an AA meeting, and you see all these God posters all over, and I'm thinking, oh, they're gonna shove God down my throat. And they have all these Bible thumpers. And, but anyway, they made us journal in treatment, and through the journaling, I started writing letters to God. And I come home, and so I'm continued the journaling every night, talking to God and writing him letters. And one night I was really struggling, and I didn't want to go back to a Lutheran church. I was looking for God, but I didn't know what I was looking for. I didn't know how to express it. So I just started trying different churches. And of course, my husband at that time was Catholic, and I knew that isn't where I wanted to go. And I didn't want to go back to the Lutheran, so I was praying to God, you know, that I needed to find him in my heart. And so I journaled that one night, that I had, you know, the head knowledge, but I didn't have the heart. And so I journaled that, and the next morning I thought, oh, okay, well, I'm going to go try this church. So going to that church, it was a Baptist church, I sit down, and the pastor comes out, and he says, you know how I do sermons in series? He says, well, because I know we're not done with this series, you know, but he says, I've decided to change, and for the next 6 weeks, we're going to talk about how to find God in your heart. I'll tell you, the hair stood up on my arms because while I was in treatment, I spent all that time waiting to hear God, you know. But I wanted to hear, Joanne, this is God, you know. The audible voice, you know. And everybody's at AA is talking about how they meditate, how God talks to them. And finally, you know, and I'm thinking, God, what's wrong with me, you know, that I can't hear you? And I spoke up in AA one time, and I says, you know, I don't hear from God. God doesn't talk to me. And one of the old timers there, he says, you know, Joanne, God doesn't speak to me in an audible voice either. He says, sometimes it's in what somebody says. Sometimes it's what you read. And other times it might be something that's on the TV, you know. But he said, that's how God speaks to me. And it was such a relief to not think there was something wrong with me because I wasn't hearing that voice. And then that was when I ended up going to church, and God spoke to me, you know. And it was so exciting because it was like, yes, he does speak to me, you know. And I've never heard God's audible voice, ever. From there, you know, I kept going to that church, and that pastor is exactly where I needed to be. You know, he was like, he got in my head and wrote sermons based around everything I struggled with. I ended up finally getting divorced because I just couldn't stay in the marriage, you know. So I moved to Billings, got a job there. I couldn't find an AA that worked. I couldn't find a church that, you know, because I knew God would lead me to the church I needed to go to, and I couldn't find that. And one night, my walls were closing in, and so still wasn't drinking, but I went to the bar because they had a casino there. And so I was back in the casino playing the machines. Another addiction and all that. And I met a man there. An old man I thought I had hit gold. And I just thought he was my soulmate. And we ended up buying a bar in Shoto. We started in Whitehall, but that fell through right in the final minute. And so we went on to Shoto and we bought a bar there. Or I should say, I bought a bar there. I thought, God, it really blessed me, you know, because that other bar, the walls were crumbling, and I thought, oh boy, God saved me from getting this bar. This wonderful man that I thought was perfect ended up being a con man that abused me and beat me up. And so after he beat me up, he was gone, and I still have this bar, but he convinced me, you know, it's amazing how mentally they can just beat you down to where you think you can't do it without them. And but I fortunately had some really good women friends that said, we'll help you, you don't need him. And they stayed with me long enough to get my brain back to where it needed to be. And then I decided, but I still continued to drink. You know, I would drink and I'd pass out at the bar and he'd pick my head up, pour drinks down after I passed out. And then after I got rid of him, I continued to drink for another year. Just because the man I believed him to be was gone. It was like going through a death, even though I knew in my head, you know, that he was no good. You know, the man I fell in love with was who I had to mourn. And so after about a year, one day I laid on that floor in my house and I just cried and I cried. And I said, God, I can't live this way anymore. You know, I don't want to continue, you know, being a drunk. And I got up and got dressed and went and saw a doctor, and he put me on an antidepressant just because when you drink as heavy as I did, your chemicals quit working, and they said that's what takes you back to wanting to drink again is your feel-good chemicals aren't working. So, and then I decided, okay, now I need to go looking for a church. And so I tried the Lutheran, I tried the Methodist, and they were the same as they are in every town. And everybody's telling me, oh, don't go to that New Life Church, you know, it's a cult. And and that day that I got up, after I cried, God healed me that day from alcoholism. He took away that desire to get drunk to numb myself. I never drank because I liked alcohol. I drank because I didn't want to feel, and I didn't want to, you know, and every time I started feeling and started hurting, I'd drink. But God took that desire away. You know, my life didn't get better. My circumstances didn't get better. In fact, they continued to get worse. But my life was better, you know. And so finally, after trying the churches, I thought, boy, none of them were working. And God spoke to me again in a thought, you know. And it's like, you know, look at the people you're listening to about the New Life Church. You know, the people in your bar, they probably never stepped foot in that door, you know. And, you know, so I thought, I got to give it a chance for myself. And I walked in there. I sat down. I loved the music. I loved the pastor's sermon. And I quietly went in because I didn't want anybody to see me. I just wanted to check it out, you know. But here comes the pastor. See, he's church Missouri. He comes up running. And he introduces himself. And I told him my name. And he says, what do you do? I said, I own a business. And what business would that be? And I kind of looked down and I went, the wagon wheel bar, because I knew, you know, a lot of churches look down their nose at bars. And, but I was there seeking God, you know, and it was just amazing, you know, how God proved to me this is where I belong. Was the next morning I opened up my bar. And it's like 8 o'clock in the morning, and here comes the pastor through the door. And he sits down, he has a Coke, and he shares his story with me. And he was raised Lutheran, too. And he has children that, you know, he had a son that had a drinking problem like I did. And, you know, we had a lot in common. In fact, we even had the same superintendent, even though I lived in Nashua and he lived in, grew up in Fairfield, you know, the same superintendent. But So anyway, I started going to that church. And I decided I knew nothing. I knew nothing other than the movie, The Ten Commandments, that I had watched on TV. Even though I'd gone to church, you know, I never paid attention growing up, and I did, you know, go through confirmation and all of that, but I wasn't paying attention. So anyway, I joined a Bible study. So I get there the first night, and anxious to learn, and they hand out the booklets and stuff, and it's about International School of Ministry. And I'm like, oh no, I'm in the wrong class. I thought this was a Bible study. I don't want to be a minister, you know, I don't want to be a minister. But it was right where God needed me to be. You know, He wanted me there, and I learned so much there. And I was the newbie there, and everybody else was a mature Christian. And I kept asking questions. I didn't understand how Paul was now, you know, Saul was Paul, and I mean, I was so confused, you know. And they would explain, they would answer my questions. And I apologized one day for asking so many questions, and they said, you know, don't apologize. There's a lot of mature Christians that probably want to ask those same questions, but are afraid to because they should know those answers. And, you know, and you bring life back to them to watch somebody growing, you know, and learning about God in front of their eyes, and they can share with you. And he says, that's a wonderful thing for all of us to be able to remember and share. And I completed those 2 years, and I was doing really good. And but in that meantime, I did get baptized. I didn't know why I wanted to be baptized, but I had a real strong urge to be baptized. So I sat down with the pastor, and he explained baptism to me. And I was done with my old life. You know, God had taken and given me a new life. But boy, I had a lot of work. And and I'm still owning the bar through this walk with getting to know God. And I'm still not understanding why everybody in church says it's all about Jesus, it's all about Jesus. And I'm going, I don't get that. Why? What about God? What about God? You know, and I didn't understand. And so I just kept taking more and more classes, and I learned more and more, and God revealed more and more to me. And He had a lot of lessons for me that were frying pans upside the head. You know, and I was really a slow learner, so there was many frying pans inside the head. And, so then I went in, and I was counseling with the pastor, and I was sharing my life with him, and I started talking to him about my dad. And I said, you know, my dad never loved me. And I knew I'd never get through this without crying. But I had brothers, and I knew that my dad loved my brothers, but he didn't love me. And I said, you know, my dad always picked on me. And at Christmas time, if I took 2 cookies, he'd say, you put that back, you don't need that. And, but he never said it to my brothers. And I knew he loved my brothers. And my dad's dead at this point. And he says, you know, Joanne, you still want your dad punished. Even though, he's dead, you know, but he says, you know, that's God's job. He says, and if God feels that your dad needs to be punished, He will deal with your dad over that. And so we prayed, and I told, you know, I said the prayer that I forgave my dad. I didn't feel nothing. I don't even know if I meant it, because I was still, you know, so hurt, and it's like, how can I believe God loves me, you know, when my dad didn't even love me? So anyway, now I'm building a, I'm sorry I'm taking so long, but God's so good. And I'm out making a new flower bed out in front of my house. And so that whole week, I'm out there digging up dirt, and it's silent. I don't have a TV on. I don't have nothing. It's just me and the dirt, you know. And so I'm thinking, and I'm thinking it's my thoughts, and it's not. Oh, that whole week, God just kept putting, and they were thoughts I had never thought before. You know, I'm out there digging, and it's like, you know, Dad never hugged the boys, you know, but, you know, He still loved them, you know. Dad didn't tell them He loved them, but you knew He loved them, you know. And so God's showing me this whole week
of how my belief and how it was
wasn't necessarily the way it was.
He showed me how God, my grandmother was, and grandfather, they were came from Norway, and they were not warm, huggy people. They were very business. You do your jobs, and you, fool around. And so my dad grew up with that. So my dad didn't know how to show affection. And God's telling me all this, and it's like, your dad showed you the only way he knew how, and that was to provide for us. And then it was about my weight, and it was like, he was concerned about my weight. My brothers didn't have a weight problem. And so it was his way of trying to watch out for me and my weight, and I'm taking it as an attack against me. And God showed me he wasn't attacking me. He was worried about me. And there was a whole movie we had. And in this whole movie, I'm young and my brother's young, and it's only the two of us at that point. And in this whole movie, I'm standing, my brother's got this pedal car, metal pedal car, that's like the most expensive battery-operated car you would find now. And that's what he got, and I get this little plastic purse that you could go to the dollar store and buy. And I'm looking at this video as an adult, and all I see is that car my brother has, and I'm mad. And all my life, growing up, until I was over 50 years old, every time that, that movie, I think about that, I get so angry. It's like, sure, look at what John gets, and then look at me, I just get this cheap little purse. Well, as I'm out there digging, I'm watching this movie in my head, and I'm not looking at my brother John and his car. I'm looking at me holding that purse, and I have the biggest smile on my face with that purse, and I'm so happy I have this purse. And so, it was just things after, time after time after time. And after about a week, I pretty much had the garden dug up, and I was standing outside looking at it, and it was like this light bulb went off in my head, and I realized that that was God the whole week, just showing me truth, and not my truth, what I believed my whole life. It was like two cement blocks fell off my shoulders, and I felt so light and so free. I knew my dad loved me, and he wasn't mean to me. I'll tell you that I think that was probably the most important thing God's ever done in my life, was to show me forgiveness and to show me, that just because we see it one way isn't necessarily the way it was. And still my circumstances are getting worse at the bar, and I know the whole reason God got me to that bar wasn't so I could have a bar. It was so I could find God in Shodo. I had to go to Shodo. And because I don't know if I would have listened otherwise, and if I hadn't gone through the circumstances that I did, I don't know if I would have reached a point of reaching out and crying out to God. And later the pastor told me, he prayed me there. He said, he says, Joanne, I prayed you to Shodo. He says, I remember driving by the wagon wheel one day, and he says, and it was a rough bar. He said they called it the Gun and Knife Club. And it was filled with druggies, and it was just a real rough bar. And I came in and I cleaned it up, and turned it into a place where people could come. But he says, I prayed God would send somebody there, to help those people. And he says there was one gal we thought was who it was. She was a regular customer at that bar, but he says, she just kind of fell away then. He says, and then here you come through the doors, and you tell me you own the wagon wheel bar, he said, and there was a lady there that was probably one of the worst alcoholics I've ever seen in my life. I don't think the woman ever was sober. I don't think she was ever sober. And she was an ornery drunkard. She was like,
you would have not thought, but
she would come in and she would talk to me. And she'd say, how did you sober up? I'd say, God did it for me. You know, I couldn't do it. I tried many times. I couldn't do it. And God did it for me. And she says, Joanne, I want what you have. And so I just started sharing with her what God's done in my life. You know, and all those things. She'd come over to my house. One night she came over and she was drunk. And she wanted to talk. And I said, Joyce, I'm not going to talk to you when you're drunk. I says, here's a blanket. Sleep on the couch. And in the morning we'll talk. So it's Sunday morning. I get up and God says, ask Joyce to church. And I start arguing with God. And I'm going, well, she won't go. You know, I mean, this woman's the worst drunk you've ever met. You know, she's not going to go to church with me. So we'll ask her anyway. So I go out there and I said to Joyce, I said, Joyce, would you like to go to church with me? And she sits there a minute. She goes, yeah, I would. And I said, okay, well, I'm going to Sunday school and I'll come back and get you before church starts. And she was ready. She was ready and she was anxious to go. And she walked through them doors and she says, Joanne, she says, as soon as I walked through them doors, she says, I could feel God there. I could feel God's presence. She says, I felt like I was home. I could feel God wrapping his arms around. And, you know, she didn't sober up immediately, you know, but she did eventually sober up. And I think I have 11 years sober and she would have had 10. Anyway, and there was another lady in the bar that was, oh, I mean, she would go home with any man that came in the door. And she too came and wanted to have what I had, you know, and I just shared with them. And then when they would fail, it was a lesson for me that when I fail and I sin, when, you know, I knew how God felt. Because every time those gals would trip and stumble, I wasn't mad at them. I was just hurting for them. I just felt so bad for them because I knew what they could have. And I thought, that's how God feels when I mess up, you know? He's not angry at me. He's just sad, you know? I mean, he wants what's best for me. And and I still, you know, I mean, this is before that. I still wasn't getting the Jesus thing when I was in the Bible study and stuff. Well, anyway, I got out of the bar. I sold the bar finally. I mean, God took me to a place where, you know, financially I was just ruined. And I couldn't, and I finally had to surrender, you know. I mean, I had done my time at that bar, you know, and people seen me go from this passed out drunk at the bar to sober. You know, and Pastor Mike says, you know, you're a good witness. You know, he says, even bars need a witness, you know. I mean, they're sick, you know, and who needs God more than people, you know. And there were people that would come and ask me, many more than those two ladies. And I would just share God with them. They always waited till it was nighttime and they were the only ones in the bar before they asked, but I would share God every time with them. I remember another time that was a really powerful moment that I knew God was talking to me with. I had been hit so bad by those poker machines that I didn't have yet another dollar in my till to pay the payouts. And I went home and I laid on the floor and I cried again. And I said, I can't do this, God, I just can't do this. And I can't go on. I'm just so hopeless, you know. I don't know what I'm going to do. For some reason, the TV was on, and about that time, Joyce Myers comes on, and she says, you know, when you're feeling so low and so helpless, you can't go on. And boy, my ears picked right up, because that is exactly what I just said. And she says, you know, that's when you count your blessings. And I sat up, and I started thinking, you know, I have a roof over my head, I have food, I have a family, I have my health. And boy, you know, it was what I needed, you know? And I realized I don't have it so bad. And I had God in my life. And I went back over to that bar and it was just a whole different attitude. My circumstances hadn't changed at all. Not a bit. I still didn't have a dollar in the till. I didn't have nothing. But God changed my attitude, you know? And I looked at it, you know, as a blessing. And I eventually did sell the bar. I didn't make any money on it and stuff. And I'm still in financial mess from it, but I'm working on that. And those two ladies, Joyce finally gave up the drinking. She wanted to get baptized. And I had, one of my best friends was like 70 some years old, and she'd been raised with her. And I would invite her to church, and she was one of those that thought the New Life Church was a cult. And I'd invite her to go with me, and she'd always have an excuse, you know, and I'd say, okay. I didn't force her, I didn't drag her to church, but she could see what God was doing in my life. She says, you have so much faith, and how do you keep going? I says, it's God that's keeping me going. If it was me, I'd be in Warm Springs, you know? and it's amazing how when you don't have the strength, boy, God will be there to help you. And Joyce would get baptized, and Mary Jean was this older lady friend of mine, and she just loved Joyce. Everybody loved Joyce, you know? She was just this poor little drunk girl, you know, that was trying to sober up. And so she wanted Mary Jean to come for a baptism, and she did. Mary Jean walked through that door, and same thing. She says, I just felt God's presence there, and she started coming to church, and she started coming to Bible study, and just like me, she had a million questions. But she was in a good Bible study group where it was mature Christians that could answer all those things for her. And but after I did that, I went to work. After I sold the bar, I had no job. My house is being foreclosed on, which they foreclosed it. And I have no money. And when the ladies took me to the restaurant to eat, and I asked them if they had any openings. And they said no, and I said, well, can I get an application? And she said, well, we're out of applications. I said, okay. And so that night, this lady I went to lunch with calls me, and she says, Joanne, the lady at the restaurant is trying to get a hold of you. She wants you to know if you can start work tomorrow. So I said, oh, absolutely. So I go there to work. And she says, we have never hired anybody without having an application. And, but can you, you know, so she was really happy to have me. And she said, I asked around about you and I heard nothing but good. So I started working for them and they were Christians. And so we listened to Christian radio in the morning. So I was being fed. You know, I had some time from the time I sold the bar until I started working at the restaurant where I just dug into the Bible and I read and I read and I read. And I just was hungry to learn. So she gave me a book. It was Joseph Prince's Destined to Reign. And I'm reading it one night in bed. I can't tell you what he said or what I read or nothing, but I'm laying there and it's like 11 o'clock at night and I'm reading this book and I have this another light bulb moment where I understood Jesus. I got Jesus. I had been begging, I had a sin that I had been begging for 20 some years for forgiveness for. And every time that sin would, I think about that sin, I go to plead for forgiveness over and over. And that moment, I knew I'd been forgiven for that sin. And I've never pled for forgiveness for it again. I remember it. I don't forget that sin. But I don't have to sit and plead and beg for God to forgive me, because he has forgiven me of that sin. He's forgiven me of all of my sins. Mm-hmm. And I have a lot of them. Perhaps, I should say, had a lot of them. And so, you know, I worked there for a while, and then got on with the government again, got back in there and decided I needed to get my retirement. And so I'm being laid off at the air base in Great Falls after a year and a half working there. And I'm one day away from being laid off. And for some reason, through this whole thing, I had a peace and a calmness. I wasn't worried, and that is so not me. I mean, I am like, oh man, what am I gonna do? I would be falling apart, I'd be bawling, I'd be crying, I mean, and I didn't, I was just calm. And you know, and all I can explain is God gave me that peace. You know, because the day before I was to be laid off, I get a phone call, and I was offered the job here in Stevensville. And so then I transferred over to here, and it's like, oh man, I don't have any money to get over there. And I thought, I'm going to have to rely on my church family to help me get me over there, you know, and I knew the people that had trailers. And then the guy, you know, Dan, that offered me the job, he mentioned something about moving expenses. I'm like, what? You know, because my position, they don't pay moving expenses for my position. I'm like the little man on the totem pole. And so, you know, and I know that wasn't in the application that I filled out, but they paid my moving expenses over here. I was worried about housing, what I was going to do for housing. Dan calls me and says, one of the ladies I work with at Main Street has a house that she's going to rent. So I called her and came over here on a house hunting trip, looked at it, and I've been living in that house ever since. Mm-hmm. And there's been times I've struggled to make the rent, and they've worked with me. And just wonderful landlords. And I didn't know why God brought me over here, but I knew he brought me here for a reason. You know, and I know it was to strengthen my faith again, because, you know, you do kind of get into that comfort zone where you don't, you know, and to me, sharing is like, I love sharing my story with people that, you know, I apologize to people I've shared it with many times, but, you know, it just, I need it to remind me. And, you know, but I told God, whatever it is you're taking me there for, I'm ready, you know, I'm ready. And my daughter was really struggling at that time, and running with some. God brought me here to get her here, and she's doing wonderful now. She's getting better every day. And so, and I know that's why he brought me here. And you know, I started at a church here that just I didn't go looking, like I did every place I've been. You know, and I know when God puts me where I need to be. You know, Pastor Mike, a new pastor that the first church I went to, and very nice people. You know, I mean, he's a good preacher and everything, but and he preaches truth. But I just, there was something missing there. I just didn't belong there. So I started church hunting with Janice, and we tried many churches, and then we came here, and the people were so nice. They were so nice. Pastor Glenn's messages were just what I needed to hear, and I have a fire again, because I'm learning, you know. I love your how you teach, and so, you know, God's still working on me. You know, I still got a long ways to go, but thank God he has never given up on me. Those two ladies I mentioned that were really bad drunks have both passed away, but they passed away knowing God. And so I know where they are, and I'm so glad that God put them in my life, and I could share God with them, and that they listened, and they got to know God. And so never miss an opportunity to share God with people, because you never know if it might be the time that they just, and my son had that happen to him in jail. And he asked God into his life, and my son was one that there is no God, you know, and he's not perfect, you know, but he asked God into his life. He was baptized, and really in the Bible. He got out of jail, though. He didn't keep grounded in the church, you know, he didn't, you know, so he's out there again, you know, he's struggling, but I know he has not ever once. The other day, I texted him because he doesn't talk on the phone, but he's saying, well, God doesn't talk. God isn't with me right now. I said, God never left you. I said, you're just choosing to listen to the wrong one. I said, right now you're listening to Satan instead of God. And if you would quit listening to Satan, you'd hear God. And I says, and you know, like me, I never heard God in an audible voice. But, you know, and those were thoughts I had. It wasn't my thoughts, it was God's thoughts. So, you know, he's blessed me beyond. And I have a good friend that is such a, oh yeah, she loves the Lord. She just, and she keeps me striving to be a better person too, you know, and just by her enthusiasm and stuff in this church. So, you know, you always have to be in it. You know, you have to surround yourself with people that love the Lord. It's very easy to be pulled away from that if you surround yourself with all the negative people, and you know, God's showing me that he's got Christopher. You know, he has saved him from dying so many times, and he's got him. It's just, it's in God's time, not mine. You know, and God will find a way, just like he showed me. He showed me things. He put people in my path. And I know he's going to do that with my son, too, and I just, you know, pray that it's soon, you know, but it'll be in God's time, and it will happen. So, anyway, that's my story, and I know I'm saying probably a lot, but it's, you know, and I didn't get that chance with my dad to form that relationship, but growing up, I always resented my mom, too, and I could not be around my mom. She drove me nuts when she'd call. My teeth would grit. And I know I was angry at her for not defending me when Dad picked on me. Well, after Ed beat me up, she came up to stay with me. And we were talking one night, and I started crying, and I started asking her why she wouldn't, why didn't she make that stop? This is before I forgave my dad. It's just little, I'm still angry at my dad. And she looks at me, and she's crying too, and she says, I'm so sorry, Joanne. I didn't know any better. And God showed me right there, you know, we're not perfect parents. And she came from an era where you didn't stand up to your husband. You know, you didn't do that stuff. And I, after that, forgiving my dad, I realized, you know, that, you know, there was nothing to stand up for, you know. But I forgave my mom that day. And thank God we had a few years of before she passed that I got to love on my mom and enjoy her. So, anyway, that's my story. And I'm sticking to it.